in the door. And that'll be your signal, and we need to reduce this stuff, being late to class all the time. Sounds benign, and while he's driving, he's thinking, oh, okay, so he did the music. Then he begins to talk to him about subliminal messaging and backward masking, and how he knew someone. This is a true story, this is what should make your hair start to stand up, because I'm talking about American public high school, and I'm talking about subliminal messages, and I'm now talking about music as you pass through. I hope you're seeing a dark connection here. He had someone who put in subliminal messages below your perceptual threshold, so that you don't know them consciously, backward masking, like in some of the albums of the Beatles, M12, or something, it's supposed to be in there, and I don't know, because I was into Merle Haggard when they came out, and so, and it said these messages, and repeated them over and over for the 8 or so minutes that it was playing, 8 or 9, during class changes. Stay in school, well, backwards masked, or whatever it was, don't drop out. Keep your school clean, don't do any graffiti, and get to class on time. Those things were laced through it subliminally, over and over again, played at every class change, but no one was aware of it. All right. This is, again, just your horror-stricken eyes are telling me that. Now, I hope this is of interest to you. This is just a freebie before the actual presentation, which was started at our workshop at 1 o'clock. But I'm here to aver, I'm the eyewitness that this was told to me directly. One of the things I do is collect the war stories of public educators. And so my question to you is, what law has been broken? And what would you do if you were the superintendent or a parent who found out about this? What would you want to have done to this principal of a state near us? It was California. I guess I can say it's big enough that it's almost anonymous. It was in California. Okay? So, I don't know what music they've chosen. But all the positive indicators went sky high. So it's now time for you to quit looking like a portrait. And now tell me, what would you do? Is there anything wrong with doing this? The benign, inculcative sort of mission, the kids weren't aware of it. We're not even sure it has an impact, by the way. Are you my timekeeper? Because we haven't started yet.
Yes.
This is just sort of the preview. It's coming to tracks. Wherever you can come, wherever you like. So, I'm listening now with a pregnant pause. Tell me, this is supposed to be a workshop session. I'm told this session is supposed to be like a half me, half you. Right? And so I'm going to do some kind of formal presentation, and then I'm going to take questions, because I have tenure as opposed to him. I won't lose my job as I answer the questions, supposedly. What's wrong with this? Anything wrong with it? Are you troubled by it? Should we do discipline to that superintendent? What if it were, instead, another message? Hate the Mormons. You know, oppressed Muslims. Beat up someone who's got same-gender attraction. Okay, if those messages were in there, what would we feel? Versus the benign messages. So I just want to know. You're just looking at me because, A, I'll bet you're not believing it happened. I promise you. Trust me, I'm a lawyer. It happened. The person that told me was very credible, and he was telling it about himself. Okay? Thoughts about it? What would you do? Yes, ma'am. I just wouldn't like it because I like transparency. In fact, we want to know what's in the heart of those principals and those leaders to know what motivates them in general about what they do. But we don't want them, without anyone's input, putting, even though those are benign messages, if they put up a poster that said, stay in school, you know, those sorts of things, we wouldn't have a problem. Anyone another thought about that? Please.
I just think anytime that's kind of underhanded like that, it just comes across as manipulative. And even if the end is beneficial in most people's lives, there's still, I mean, as she said, transparency, there's still some sort of, like, you feel like you got cheated, or you know, there's some sort of negative connotation to it, where it's like, hey, just put up a poster or have a, you know, school assembly or stay in school or something. It's like, at least you know what you're being taught.
Right. So there's something in our American hearts, there are others who aren't from America, but it's probably a human heart too, but I'm just going to say in our American hearts, that we don't like that being done. I'm going to just turn one other question, and then in 1 minute we'll start the actual presentation. None of this is actual presentation. Okay. Are you about to raise your hand?
I was going to raise my hand. I was going to say, I'm all in favor of that as long as I'm the one that gets to put the input in. So
okay.
What's being told
right.
to them?
Hate the Yankees. Love the Red Sox. I would do that. That'd be good. Hey, so tell me then, what's illegal about what he did? We haven't actually started. This is just a free. What's illegal about it?
So I missed the first part of the story. Can you just update those of us that can?
Briefly, subliminal. We haven't actually started, Bob. This is just extra info. You know, this is extra innings. Subliminal messages put in the overhead music in the high school when they passed that said benign things, but no one knew about it. And I promise you it happened, because I got it direct from the person who's a friend. The person who's now deceased, so none of us can get in trouble.
Yes.
What's illegal about that? Pardon me? Somehow, something about freedom of speech, freedom to receive messages? I got to tell you, as a lawyer, I'm going to have a little bit of trouble prosecuting that case. As a school leader, I'm going to have a little bit of trouble trusting that principal. And so it's just interesting. So now we're going to stop. That probably left with an unsettled and sort of creepy feeling. It'll continue during the rest of this session. Don't worry. But it's also to warm you up, to let you know that, again, some of this is going to be me droning on and being boring, and the other half of it's going to be you. And so if it's all right, it's a workshop in that sense, okay? And so now it's 1 o'clock, so we're ready to start. Is there anything I need to turn it over? Are you introducing me?
I'm introducing you.
Okay, thank you.
Although you clearly don't need any introduction.
Well, I didn't want him to waste the time to head there.
I appreciate that. This is great. It's been an exciting day. And we're grateful to Professor Ferrin for coming. He's the Associate Professor of Educational Leadership and Foundation.
Actually, I'm a
full professor. He's also affiliated with Tinley Institution here on campus. Before joining the IU, he's with his executive assistant to the president, the trustee liaison officer, and secretary of the board of education. Research focuses on education law, policy, constitutional law. He's lectured internationally, published widely. He has a bachelor's degree and a JD from the UIU and a doctorate in education at Harvard. I've worked with him many times over the years on religion and law and education issues, and we're very pleased to have him join us. We'll give us time to him, with a notice that we're going to end at 2 o'clock. So we'll give up a 2-minute break between this and the next session.
All right. Thank you very much. The room is big enough. Would you like me to use the mic, or if my voice is already annoying enough? What would you prefer, mic or no mic? Some might need it for your hearing. Mic, back row, you get to vote. Mic or no mic? Just give me an indication.
For the video, probably the mic. The
video, would you like mic?
Yeah.
Okay,
I don't know.
It'd be annoying, I'm sure, to some of you. But let's turn it on. And I'm sorry, sometimes when I get excited, I speak too loud. I always speak too fast. Although my friends from New York, think I speak slow. And I tell them, in Utah, just because we speak slow doesn't mean we think slow. So welcome, but then again, in my case, maybe so. So welcome. Good to have you here. We're going to do just a tiny bit of some videos and some other things. But as I said, this is designed the way it was described to me when I was invited, as a workshop, which is half of my time presenting, then half kind of supposed to be question, answers, discussion, learning from each other. All right? And so, if it's all right, I'd just like to start with a couple of things, and I'll do what you shouldn't do in good pedagogy. We're going to also see a video in a bit, but I'm pretty sure that a lot of you haven't progressed beyond high school. Whenever you knew there was going to be a movie, it was just cooler, I'm sure. So we're going to watch a couple of videos that will help frame the issue. And I'm going to invite you to go ahead and be unsettled by anything I said, but please don't be offended, because I really care. And I care about the schools. I care about religious freedom and things. But this is an area where anything we say is liable to offend someone or hit someone in a harder way. And some years ago, the law school had me go to UCLA and be engaged, years before this really got big, in debates on same-sex marriage at UCLA Law School and things. And at dinners and things with people in the evenings, I noted, when I talked about same-sex marriage, I'm cool, I'm calm, I'm collected. But for someone who has family members or they themselves are dealing with same-gender attraction, it was an emotional, challenging issue. It was, and so we need to be gentle and kind when we deal with each other in this area, especially about religion in the schools, because we might go to hell. And so if it's all right, I'd like to ask us to pay attention to a couple of things. We need to recognize, I'm going to frame some of the issues. There's some sheets up here. I'm going to frame some of the issues for us to discuss in some ways. And you know what? The right and the left are both going to take some hits, you know, in a sense for having been asleep at the wheel or having exacerbated a current challenge in America. And so just assume that I'm not happy in either camp. I'm not comfortable in any place. And let's see what we understand from each other. I would suggest that we need to recognize, in a sense, that when we deal about trusting and believing in people, there are some key things I think we need to recognize. And I think we need to recognize that we're not going to agree with each other's. Tolerate thy neighbor, and not lower my standard, and just set more realistic goals. And I would suggest we need to recognize in the public schools are a little bit like Poland. Historically, Poland was Poland, meaning it was got to be poor, because empires fought on their land, and it's hard to raise a family, it's hard to raise a crop when they've been, the environmental consequences of war have been acted out on your battleground. The public schools is that Poland for so many contending forces. They range from the Christian Coalition, who has been so organized politically for so long, and I'm noting that some of their height is when you saw the trend line that Dr. Monson was showing starting to go up with people not affiliated with religion. Was that a vote with people speak that we didn't like, they didn't like the political activism? I don't know. But at that point, the Christian Coalition was on purpose taking over school boards. And then a little later, on purpose, they called for everyone to leave the public schools. Now, I'm just talking about excellence in education, the Christian Coalition at that time. I don't know where they are exactly now. But there's been that's happened. Okay, but on the other side, for a host of reasons, and I may ask you to explain to me what you think the reason is, we have no Protestants on the Supreme Court now. And you noticed, if you read the full decision, that it was noted in one of the dissents, and I now forget which dissent, it was Scalia's dissent, that, well, you know, the United States Supreme Court is made up of a bunch of patrician weenies, basically what he's saying, that don't represent America. You know, they're all gone to the most best and expensive schools. He said, and everybody went to Harvard or Yale Law School. I don't know who else besides Thomas went to Yale. I think he's our only failure on the court. And so he notes that, you know, there's not a single evangelical, there's not a single Protestant. But you're, and I'm not saying that describes and explains everything, but it explains something, because historically, Baptists, by the way, when we mentioned the oppression and the violence against religions, we've left out a couple, and that's Baptists. In this country, early on, Baptists were jailed for being Anabaptists, for believing in Baptists, for not believing, for all kinds of different things. And there was an extermination order, in case we don't remember or know it. Not just on the Mormons in Missouri, but there was an extermination order on Quakers. There's a reason Rhode Island became Rhode Island. And I worked in Rhode Island for a number of years. At Bryant University is in Rhode Island. And I just suggest part of the challenge may be, in part, because Catholic members of the court and other members of the court, now I was talking about the left and the problems that might have come, and the Baptist and the Christian Coalition, and the left has done its own share. We've already seen those now. But also Catholics, who aren't Protestants necessarily, have always had a challenge with the public schools, because the public schools fostered a sort of a pan-Protestantism. They sort of said, you know, religious schools, and how Horace Mann said this specifically and directly, religious schools, please, give up some of your control over the religious message for these positive things that will happen if we have a common school system, we have, instead of pauper schools and church schools, I think, we have a whole system of, you know, compulsory education. And he was a very, very compelling speaker, Horace Mann. And because of that, he convinced people, but the Catholics kind of got left out. And so there's always been a challenge. And now that the majority of the court, six, are Catholic, their viewpoint is starting to surface perhaps a little bit, although American Catholics aren't like other Catholics, and not all Catholics are like other Catholics. But some of those that are on the court are very Catholic. You know, Thomas not only went to parochial school, but then he went to Holy Cross. That's very Catholic. Scalia is not only very Catholic, but his son's a priest. That's very Catholic. You know, those, so they're more Catholic than a lot of American Catholics. And with decisions like the Good News Club case, and maybe the Bowser case, and Zelman versus Simmons-Harris, and maybe others, there's been a challenge. And I want to explain it now, and then we're going to stop and we're going to watch a video. So don't worry, don't go so unconscious yet. Justice Thomas, and I understand that the case I'm talking about is called Good News Club, was a plurality opinion. We're not certain whether he's speaking for a current majority of the court or not. But he said things like this. Any aid, I guess this was in Mitchell v. Helms, where he said this quote, Mitchell v. Helms, any aid that can appropriately be given to any public school can be given to any private school. So if it's legal in a public school, it's not legal in a public school to pay for a religious message, but it is legal to build a public school. It is legal to pay for the salary of people at public schools. It is legal to pay for the books. And Thomas, I'm very sure from Mitchell v. Helms and others, aren't worried about any money under the Establishment Clause being given to religious schools. And that's what resounds, in a sense, and reverberates in Zelman versus Simmons-Harris about vouchers going to parochial schools and others. So there's a reason for some of this tension and some of the fight that's going back and forth, because there are other people, including Jews and minority religions, who say, oh, if you get religion too close into schools, it's always going to affect the minority religions in a negative way, or it can, because education is locally controlled in general, although we're taking that away. And there's often, locally, a religious majority. And so now we have a tension there. And this is what fuels, in some measure, the Conference of Christians and Jews, which has turned out to be the conference, and because they didn't want to exclude the Muslims and others, and other groups who said, we actually, the Joint Baptist Council, we actually don't want prayer in schools because it denigrates schools. Okay, not everyone, not all of us are in agreement, but we're contending over religious freedoms and these issues in the public schools. And then in the Good News Club case, which was a case that dealt with, is it legal to put a limitation, is it constitutional to put a limitation on your limited open forum? The public schools are generally a limited open forum, which means you can limit speech, but it's got to be a reasonable limitation on the speech. And in Good News Club, the issue came up that said, at right around 3 o'clock or so, adults would come in and they'd take over the classroom and they would do things that to me seemed quite religious. They would have altar calls, they'd have confessing Jesus, they'd have people come down and explain, and they'd read scriptures. Or I'd like my kid to be that religious in seminary, for that matter. It seemed like a religious exercise to me. However, Justice Thomas and some of those justices tried to shelter, and did shelter that, under what we call the Lamb's Chapel Doctrine. If you're not lawyers and things, you just don't get too bored yet, but we have an infinite threshold for boredom ourselves, those who are lawyers. Lamb's Chapel Doctrine said, you can rent the school after hours, even if you're a religious group. In a lot of places, there was a limitation on their limited open forum that anybody can rent the school after hours as long as you don't do these basic things. And one was, we don't rent to religious groups. For that, separation between church and state. But in the Lamb's Chapel case, and maybe it's a good decision, I don't know for sure yet, I'm still thinking it through, the United States Supreme Court said, just because you're a religious group, if what you're doing is just basically teaching values, like other groups would, the Boy Scouts or others would, and in the Lamb's Chapel case, they were showing a film, and that film was about parenting from a Christian perspective. Then the Supreme Court of the United States said, the mere fact that you're a religious group cannot be a reasonable limitation on your open forum. Okay? So the issue became, in, now the Good News Clip case for Thomas became, and not just Thomas, was what they were doing teaching values? So they're protected under Lamb Chapel. Or was it a religious exercise? Because they were coming in, they were doing altar calls, they were singing hymns, they were reading scriptures, they were starting with prayer, they were telling kids their duty to profess Jesus and those sorts of things. And Thomas said, and I may cite it for you later a little bit, but Thomas basically said, it's just teaching values. And he basically said, anytime religious groups do what they're doing, they're just teaching values. There's no real difference between the values they teach and the values other groups teach. All right, now that's problematic to me, perhaps, to some of us, perhaps, because where is free exercise? If everything that a religious group does is teaching values, and maybe he did that so they would be protected under Lamb's Chapel, and it fits his analysis, perhaps, but it opened up a whole lot of contention. So can you see how these kinds of positions, some of them from religious groups, might have framed some of our challenges and our unease when people get engaged in the public schools? And I'm going to add in a minute, but I want to show you a video for a minute, so I'm going to take, you know, some of my time with a little video. They add people's unease with religious peoples in the public schools. There's some unease with religious people, and I want to talk about that. And then we're going to have a discussion. But right now, I think you want to see a video. And this video, if I can get to it directly, is going to be right here. There we go.
Well, it only took 30 seconds, but a substitute teacher in Pasco County says it may have cost him his career. So what's the charge from the school district?
I'll back that up.
Wizardry. Tampa Bay 10 News reporter Janie Porter explains.
It's a 30-second magic trick.
Quiet.
Well, it only took 30 seconds, but a substitute teacher in Pasco County says it may have cost him his career. So what's the charge from the school district? Wizardry. Tampa Bay 10 News reporter Janie Porter explains.
It's a 30-second magic trick.
What? Come on.
Where a toothpick disappears, then reappears. But after performing it in front of a classroom at Rushy Middle School, substitute teacher Jim Piculus says his job did a disappearing act of its own.
I got a call in the middle of the day from the head of the supervisor of substitute teachers. And Jim, we have a huge issue. You can't take any more assignments. You need to come in right away.
When Piculus went in, he learned his little magic trick cast a spell that went much farther than he'd hoped.
I said, well, Pat, can you explain to me what this is? Can you say anything at all? You've been accused of wizardry.
I spoke with the assistant superintendent of the Pasco County School District who said it wasn't just the wizardry and that Piculus had other performance issues, including not following lesson plans and allowing students to play on unapproved computers. Accusations Piculus says he knew nothing about.
That I think was embellished after the fact to try to cover what they were saying to me.
After the magic trick, Rushy's principal requested Piculus be dismissed. Now the incident may have bewitched his ability to get a job anywhere.
Well, I still have no idea what my discipline involves because I've never received anything from the school district actually saying what entailed.
Leaving him to wish he knew a little more abracadabra, at least enough to get his job back.
Basically, I'm in.
Okay, so there's a challenge, and we also have challenges over issues such as, you know, evolution, the teaching of evolution in the schools, and we get pushback back and forth there too, don't we? And then others worry about us as religious peoples in lots of other ways. And so I just want to, I'm not going to take time to have us watch Richard Dawkins, but you've heard of Richard Dawkins with the selfish gene and other things, and he's a very, very engaged speaker about education and other things, and beyond condescending about people with belief. I'm just going to give you a quick experience with with him, if I can get it started, we're going to have to find out, I don't know what magic, what wizardry you just did, so, let me see.
I would like to ask you, Professor, what do you have to say to someone, who has met the risen and living Lord Jesus Christ, who has walked with God for 50 years?
He's listened to Dawkins talk about evolution and how it needs to be taught. And if you believe in God at all, you can't even be a scientist, according to Dawkins. That's the position that he's taking.
What do you have to say? Because I assure you, for my life, it has been no delusion.
If you had been born in India, I dare say you would be saying the same thing about Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva. If you had been born in Afghanistan, I dare say you would be saying the same thing about Allah. If you had been born in Viking Norway, you would be saying the same thing about Votan. If you had been born in Olympian Greece, you'd be saying the same thing about Zeus and Apollo. The human mind is extremely susceptible to hallucination.
Give me another half a minute or that.
Sir, I'm being allowed by the friend I used to work with to come back. I cannot afford to build my life on hallucination, but on Jesus Christ, who is the rock. And it is that I have asked you to address, please.
You are obviously sincere, but obviously I do not share your beliefs, and I think you are hallucinating. That's all I can say. I don't doubt your sincerity.
Okay.
He's got other more condescending things to say about those who don't accept everything he has to say about natural selection. And his basic thesis would be, in education, that, and I've heard him say it, theory A, you know, I can't understand theory A, therefore theory B. He assumes that if people understand him about natural selection, that they'll believe and understand and choose what he's saying. He's just a representative for the fact that there are contending forces in our public schools, and they're challenging. Give me a few more minutes, and then we're going to open this up to everyone. Another issue that's come up, it seems to me, is that it's become almost pathological to be a believer. And it's that feel when I travel, you know, throughout Europe, that those who believe are more likely to be violent, and they're troubling to people. They're worried about them in some ways. It just seems, I'm just giving you my own gestalt for traveling and things. Well, there is a lot of research, I think I've got, that seems to show that those who are deep believers in religion, now how do I get that, back to being a, just delete it, it'll give me that. I've got two screens going out now, okay. And so, you can't see that, never mind, let me see if I can read it to you. Homo-negative Christians loving the sin but hating the sin. This is a footnote for a paper of mine. Religious orientation, anti-homosexual sentiment, and fundamentalism among Christians. And so, I'd just like to have us recognize, and we don't need to show more, that there's a, it's seen as a challenge to be a believer, be religious. We'll leave that up there. So, Alport was referred to briefly by Dr. Monson. And so Gordon Alport provided some great research about all kinds of things, and he's one of the fathers of contact theory. We use contact theory for a lot of things, including the intent, which we haven't quite done, to desegregate the schools. That positive things happen when you're with someone and changes happen. In the social science research, when they talk about the interactions of religiosity and the interactions of type of religiosity, and Dr. Monson knows this, and he said, oh, we've got to look at this. They have divided religious peoples up into intrinsic, extrinsic, and quest. And so intrinsic people are what you and I might call people who deeply believe, like the person who's asking the question, who use it, it's internalized, and they use religion to answer, to guide their lives. Extrinsic sort of think that, well, I'm part of this church. You can also think of it as a continuum almost, okay? So they use intrinsic, Extrinsic, and Quest in their research. Here's what's interesting about this research. They ask questions about certain types of religious views that produce prejudice towards minorities, including LGBT students and individuals. And a certain type of religious individual performs better than others on the prejudice scales. That type of person are those who, they're on Quest. They don't really know whether they believe their religion or not. So now we take religion and we divide it up more. And that's troubling, and it spawned a lot of research that says religious and deep believers are a problem in public schools. They're a problem especially about dealing with gay and lesbian and transgenders and other individuals in the schools. But these studies are often conducted with cohorts of university students as their subjects. It's not exactly open. As you may know, the people that answer these surveys are often required as psychology majors to answer surveys. And so a lot of them are not only university students, they're psychology students, which may not be like the divinity school students. I don't know. It just might not be a perfect sample. And the idea about intrinsic or extrinsic, might not work. But when they talk about those who actually attend religious observances regularly, they tend to measure high on their research on prejudice scales and low on altruism scales. Did you hear what I just said? I hope you're troubled. If you're a believer, your brow should be furrowing a little bit now. The more someone believes in this research, and it's all over, and it's being utilized for public policy, it feels like to me, in lots of ways. It's being utilized in the academia of today. And here's some of the things they would do. Here's how you ask the question. If you ask this question of intrinsics, extrinsics, and quests, which are three types of people, remember, inside of their own religious background, here's one of the questions. It's a key question. It would be beneficial to society to recognize that homosexuality and bisexuality is as natural as heterosexuality. And then they use your religious beliefs and how deep you hold them to determine whether or not, in answer to that question, you're not going to be able to engage in pro-social behavior. You're going to be prejudiced and things. Well, I'd suggest there might be confounding interactions in the answers to a question like that, such as the term natural. In my religious background, not all religions treat natural in the same positive way. In my faith tradition, there's an ancient, well-known classic pronouncement regarding human nature. Here it is, and some of you will recognize it. For the natural man is an enemy to God, and has been from the fall of Adam, and will be forever and ever unless he yields to the enticing of the Holy Spirit and putteth off the natural man, and becometh a saint through the atonement of Christ the Lord, and becometh as a child submissive, meek, humble, patient, full of love, willing to submit to all things that the Lord seeth fit to inflict upon him, even as a child doth submit to his father. And they can't be lawyers. I think it's in there somewhere. Well, I'd suggest that the confounding about it's natural might not have much to do with prejudice in a sense, but have a lot to do with your belief in and your type of doctrine. And I'm just going to suggest that their questions, their instruments, and the people they use to study might not be sophisticated and nuanced enough to return the research or findings they ought to return. And I think that's challenging. There's classic research conducted by Batson, Floyd, Meyer, and Winter, and replicated by others, that look about the Christian distinction between loving the sinner but hating the sin. All right, then can Christians go ahead and still serve someone, and they use someone who's gay? By the way, on these measures, they're not using to decide whether someone's, full of prejudice or not. They're not using race anymore. They're not using taking care of the poor or the sick or the needy. It's all about gay, lesbian individuals. Well, that is a new sea change that may or may not be an accurate gauge about antisocial versus pro-social behavior, about prejudice versus non-prejudice. And so they're looking for universal compassion. So they gave university students, again, mostly psychology students. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with psychology students, okay, I'm just saying. The opportunity to help another same-sex student apply for and conduct activity aimed at winning a prize that would provide funds. Some subjects were told the student that were given the opportunity to help was homosexual and intended to use the prize if needed, if received, to attend the gay pride rally. Other students were told the student they could choose to help was homosexual and hoped to use the prize money to visit his or her grandparents. The other substitutes were merely told without any comment on sexual orientation that the student was intending to use the prize money to visit his or her grandparents. Not surprising, the intrinsics were statistically less willing to help homosexual students in general, and especially to attend a gay pride rally. I'm not sure that we've discovered prejudice. I think we might have discovered a political kind of culture war going on. I'm just not sure. And so I could go on and I could bore you even further with this. But let me give you this opposite finding. However, there's another body of research that seemed to somewhat contradict these claims and trends. For example, Bassett, Baldwin, Tamaro, Macmer, Mundig, Werling, and Shirky did similar research, but they used a sample of individuals who all were high on the intrinsic faith scale, 93% of them rated themselves above the midpoint on that scale, and were attending a Christian liberal arts college, and it wasn't BYU. They found the research subject very likely to help a gay or lesbian individual in a task for which they sought assistance. When the task for the subject was seeking assistance included a student who was gay but who was not sexually active but was practicing celibacy, they were very, very likely to assist a student. All right, does that sound like prejudice? Or does that sound like an understanding of duties before God? Now, maybe that's not understood, I understand, in the public market. It appears that the conception of loving the sinner, not the sin, was influenced by the determination of the acceptability of the action, or once again, a reification of the sin, not the sinner. I hope you're following on this. And here's a surprising finding from that research. When they tested the same students in the second year and the second semester and then the second year of their attendance at that Christian college, they reported a higher level of acceptance of gay and lesbian individuals on the test scales. In other words, more exposure to deeply religious faculty on a deeply religious campus over time made them more likely to accept and be willing to love and serve gay and lesbian individuals. I'm just telling you, though, that research I just cited is not well known and not well written about. There's hosts of the other research findings showing that religious people are a problem. And we've set up the problem in some ways because some religious peoples have wanted to help there be funding through the Establishment Clause, Catholic justices on the court, for example, and others have wanted to be active politically about taking over public schools and things. And we may be experiencing backlash from that. And there are lots of challenges for us and now I'm going to turn the time over to you so we can discuss. There are a lot of challenges for us engaging in the public schools because people are afraid of religious believers because we're seen as kind of nuts and kind of antisocial instead of pro-social, not altruistic, willing to just take really subjective, if you listen to Dawkins, hallucinations and have that teach us to kill people or whatever. That's what's in the mind, it seems like, to be of people. So people are troubled by those who believe deeply. And we also have to be careful because religious minorities don't necessarily feel reassured by having more freedom of religion or religious practices in a public school, because then it tends to make them feel sometimes that they're overcome by majoritarian values. And so I've just framed now a bunch of problems in the public forum and issues that deal with liberty and freedom in the schools. Before we close, I'm going to, if you don't mind, tell you a bit about some of Utah's regs and things that may be interesting, including regs about how you can waive out of curriculum, regs about how teachers can speak about their beliefs, which may or may not be constitutional, but they're the law, and they'll protect teachers under qualified immunity if they follow it, and it's probably constitutional. But now I'm going to stop and say, we've got problems in the public schools. We've got parents who feel like they're being silenced. We've got fear on all sides of the spectrum. The very religious in minority religions and the non-religious, and religion is seen sometimes in the public forum as an enemy. And then we have a lot of other challenges in the public schools that make it difficult to make any change at all because schools are really squishy. You push here and it just sort of sovereign immunity and qualified immunity absorbs it, and no change happens very easily. So I'm going to start with two quick things I know you can do, and then let's see what we should be doing about religious freedoms in the public schools. This will ensure you go to heaven while you have hell on earth. Run for school board. You could run for the school board because the climate of what happens in a local school The climate of how we do a gay pride day or a day of silence and who we let speak and who we let not speak and who gets in trouble for wearing a t-shirt that says, like in Harper versus Poway, and I reject gay marriage, right? I don't remember the exact language, but and those things, a lot of that climate is set by the school board in a lot of ways. And stay active, especially in grade schools where you can really get active, in your school there. You know, invite people to go to breakfast and whatnot and be active there so that you're not seen as the enemy if you're a religious believer, and so you can have impact, and so that your voice can be heard when they say, I don't know if you know how this impacts religious believers. Because you know what? Catholics and biblical conservatives may have more burdens with the public schools than Latter-day Saints, for example. If I've got a Latter-day Saint family, and if I were to put a matrix of things taught in the schools up here, do we really care as Latter-day Saints if they teach about the fossil record and that it's very old? Do we really care if they teach that the earth is really old? Do we care what they teach about evolution? Some do, some don't. But if I'm a biblical conservative and I have taught my children to live by every word in the Bible, my beliefs are being denigrated and made to look foolish all the time to my kids. And so I think we also need to recognize we're not all happy campers, and I'm not sure we can keep the public schools while we continue to have a very politically active Christian coalition and biblical conservatives who are being pushed out in some ways, and a very troubled Catholic group who aren't being welcomed in some ways. We need to find ways to preserve the public schools and to preserve a neutral area, because not everything that's not my religion is irreligion. There's got to be something neutral, or you can't operate a First Amendment which says, you know, no establishment, but also says exercise. But now we have a Supreme Court that has trouble defining what exercise of religion is. By the way, if you have trouble defining what exercise of religion is, then how do you deal with a religious person saying, I'm not just doing free exercise of speech, this is free exercise of religion. Or saying, wait, I'm not establishing religion, I'm doing free exercise of speech. And you try to hybridize those rights, because people really want to be able to speak out and do things. We have kids who are told, who's your hero? And when they say Christ, the teacher says, oh, wait, not Christ though. Okay? And you hear those kinds of things, we've got tension in the schools. So how do we protect religious freedoms? And when it comes to this curricular issue, you know what's happening. Harper versus Turley. In some states like Massachusetts, the learning standards require that kids learn how to understand all the different types of families that exist. Learn how to understand and talk about gender orientation discrimination. Now, that's not in every state, I understand. Doesn't mean it's not coming, especially after such a ruling. I don't want to try now here to predict everything that's going to come down the line in terms of curriculum and things. And so we need to stay involved. And so with that, and now that Cole's here, we can now learn what we're going to actually do. What questions, comments, or suggestions do you have? And I'm kind of conversant with the public schools and how hard they are to affect. I care about the public schools, by the way. They're not the enemy. They're Poland, the battleground in which we fight. Thank you.
Part of the genesis of how teachers teach in K-12, at least with my experience in Washington State, I looked at the curriculum in some major state-supported universities in Utah, and the curriculum content that is in the Ed School, where our future teachers are being taught, is very biased to pro-abortion, pro-left-wing heroes studied as leaders in education, with the deafening absence of traditional values leaders. And yet,
are we hearing this okay? Does he need to have the mic for us to hear his comment? Are we okay? Okay, keep going.
So my point is that, and I can produce, you know, an essay from the New York Times showed all the higher ed associations endorsing the critical importance of diversity in higher ed education, defined as perspective and background diversity.
And orientation diversity.
Well, this essay actually didn't.
Well, it is now.
Yeah,
it is. I mean, these associations said it's not a comfortable place to be.
I know, but producing this letter, endorsed by all the credible higher ed associations, they just mentioned background and perspective diversity. My point being, then how do you square that definition of diversity with the deafening absence of traditional values as included in the higher ed curriculum when they are championing the pro-abortion and left-wing heroes.
That's a good comment. I'm going to answer shortly, but I'm going to look for others to help with this. Part of the challenge is the Supreme Court would say one thing. Now, they may back up, but right now they've often said, teach about religion. Teach about the history. The pilgrims didn't come as a collective, you know, economically. They came about religion. You know, and it wasn't anti-Catholic backlash that put what's in Utah's constitution that says a school system free of sectarian control. So it's not all one thing. That was anti-Mormon backlash, if anything. And so part of the challenge is this. There's a political dimension. That's why I'm back to the solution is stay involved in school boards. It's way boring. People will say you're going to hell when you have positive motives, but it makes an impact. Because I have dealt with and helped and tried to work with people who are not LDS, for example, in Utah, who were losing their assignment to teach Utah history because everyone said they were establishing the Mormon faith. And the guy who's telling me this is drinking coffee and smoking while he's telling me this, and he's not even LDS in the slightest, and he loves the history. And so part of it is political. Anytime we talk about anything that comes up, I prepare superintendents and principals, and I try to get them to be heroic and strong about this. But so far, most of them, when an issue comes up in Utah at least, about church and state, they have to take early retirement because they can't quiet down their community. They unrest. And so we need to make a safe way to talk about it. We need to be engaged in the school board. We need to be engaged in the PTA, especially PTA to have a big impact on high schools. I understand that. But it's easier to have an impact on K-6, K-8, you know, in a sense. So all I can say is you're right. And it's in the textbooks. It's all over. But also equally, the other side would say, and you really mamby-pamby down to teach them science and evolution, too. So we have something that's acceptable. So we just need to stay involved. If we leave it, then there's going to be the eggheads in universities, especially state universities. Thank you for saying state universities. As BYU, we wouldn't do this, would we? We use a lot of the same textbooks, I understand. It's just going to go on with a current orthodoxy if we're not careful. And so the answer is not exactly legal. It's not illegal. It's probably political and being engaged. And while we're engaged, helping people understand why we're not dangerous because we're deep believers. And maybe accessing some of this research. If anybody wants, I have this article I did on this. It's in the BYU Journal of Law and Education. Just look up my name, Scott Ferrin. It was from 2011. It is 2011. In fact, And if anybody needs to and wants that site, my email address, Ferrin, F-E-R-R-I-N, at byu.edu. It's kind of a long article, so take your notes. Thank you. Very good. Other thoughts or suggestions along that line or another issue of how we deal with freedom of religion, how we preserve it? Because another challenge is when we have a diversity day, and there have been Catholic kids that have had to deal with this, and we invite ministers to show, because there seems to be a push to show that true spirituality and true religion is one that doesn't define homosexual activity as negative. You've heard that now more than you ever did before. And so some religions are going to not be seen as viable versus others, it seems, in the schools. And there have been a case where, and it's happened more than once, but with the case I'm aware of, a Catholic student who said, well, you brought these ministers in to speak for gay and lesbian acceptance and whatnot. Could I invite my pastor to come in? If I'm Catholic, could I have the priest come in and teach our views on this in our diversity? Oh, no, that would be hate-filled. And they weren't allowed to. So when she filed her lawsuit, well, they let her speak. But they limited how much she could speak, and it's pretty uncomfortable. And when those kinds of things happen, what are religious, deeply observant Christians and others going to do? They're going to take their chances, they're going to use vouchers, they're going to go to charters that might be a little happier and friendlier, or they're going to go to private schools, or they're going to homeschool often, more often, because we didn't make a safe place. So I just add that as another part of that challenge, that issue. Diversity, I also think we ought to be pushing for diversity should include those of us, getting to be in the minority, who are willing to change what we want to do because of a value that we believe in. That should be a kind of diversity that we might want to consider protecting in public schools, especially now as it's getting to be a minority view, it looks like, you know, over time. Please.
So it sounds like to me that maybe as you get involved, like in a school board or whatnot, that maybe the vocabulary you use is important, the words that you use.
Did you hear that? She is absolutely right. It's not only the vocabulary, but it's the way you interact with people. And so she said, if you get involved in the school board, hey, I do want to disabuse you. It will not be fun. there'll be periods of extreme boredom punctuated by periods of absolute pain. You know? And your fellow citizens thinking you have black motives when you have the purest of motives. Even over little things like, can the football team go to Hawaii for this trip or something? And you're the antichrist because you said, no, I don't think we can afford that, you know, or something. And people just don't know how to moderate their discussion about you. But it's worth doing. And if I'm going to the pearly gates, I'm going to just put there, you know, I served on the school board, you know, and I'm pretty sure they'll let me in for having already served time in hell. So if you would, I would suggest that all of us could learn how to reassure and not seem like a nutcase. Now, I'm on the Communities of Care Committee in Provo. We're just getting started. It's something that came out of Washington and things. And I'm going to be embedded with those people. I'm going to start looking. I tone down all my rhetoric from in there. And Provo's, you know, Provo's not all about religion. You know, Provo's kind of like the rest of the world in some ways, too, now. And our superintendent and our assistant superintendent, they're not LDS, those sorts of things. And so we all need to learn how to speak the language, even for Latter-day Saints. You know, for Latter-day Saints, you probably don't know, or maybe you do, but the term proselyting, we use it as going on a proselyting mission, is a negative term for most Christians. We would want to say witness. Do you understand some of these things that we could just learn? And they'll be willing to have us learn vocabulary if they know us and they know our hearts. They know what we stand for. And research tends to show that in professional learning communities, which isn't a school board, it's a group of teachers at grade level, when they have a shared vision, they trust more. Even if they're kind of jerks to each other, but the dimension statistically, and I have a doctoral student who just did this, the dimension statistically that really pops out when we do our ANOVAs and our statistical correlations is if they have a shared vision. And so maybe that's the thing. You learn to use the vocabulary, learn to explain why I don't hate gay and lesbian individuals, you know, and go forward from there and use that vocabulary. Learn, you know, what queer means in that place. Learn what transgender may or may not mean. And in Utah, learn the laws. Utah, for example, we passed a new law that is about religious freedom and religious rights and protection. And I had someone tell me, well, they were told they have to have a special bathroom for the transgender, which represents, by the way, 0.025 of the population in general, so that's not a lot of people. So a whole bathroom for them, not cost-effective in a building. And I said, no, you better have your council read that statute, because Utah statute does not require you to have a specific bathroom for transgender. It's more reasonable about that. And by the way, Utah's new law about this also helps you understand how to tell if someone really is transgender. And they use the DSM-5's definition. They don't want some kid in high school. We had a politician that mentioned this. I don't know who it was. Was it Biden? I wish that in high school I could have said I was transgender to get into the girls' locker. So he said that, and we got, appropriately, he got kind of slammed for saying that. But we don't want kids to just pretend. And Utah's law on religious rights and freedoms that was just passed this last session takes care of that. How you show if someone honestly has made themselves transgender. And transgender, by the way, doesn't mean purely surgical. No, it includes just orientation change, dress change, and or hormone therapy and whatnot. And if we can learn how to love those kids, how to love those people, how to speak their vocabulary so that they don't instantly say, oh, you as a believer or you as a Mormon, I know where you are on this. You hate me and my kids. We can't work together. Well, we got problems. But when they figure out that you can still believe deeply and you can still love and work with them on the things that you ought to, it helps. So you said it again, run for school board or stay engaged in the schools and learn a vocabulary that's respectful and honors those. Because, by the way, the people on this other side of the debate that may be less religious is really heartfelt. And they call the values spiritual values. And they are. They're very deep, emotional, and spiritual to them. I, you know, would say that it's a little different than the way I understand spirituality, but I think I understand it. So, thoughts, are there problems or other solutions to the problem on how we engage in the public schools and how we deal with issues to preserve religious freedom in the schools.
If I may, as a cameraman, ask the question. I'm actually curious to hear you speak to the role that students themselves can play.
Good
in the
question.
School. I'm kind of thinking, you know, what can I tell my kids to say to the teacher if, you know, they feel they need to assert their religious rights? in a way that will not make them out to be the problem child.
Wonderful. Because you notice what happened on those charts. And I'm hearing it from LDS kids regularly. They just want to have everybody know they love everybody and they accept everybody and whatnot. And they aren't armed with why or what to do or say. So let's remember a few things that are bedrock rights that kids don't know. Kids have the right to proselyte. Now, I'm going to say witness. The public school doesn't, but the First Amendment only protects you from the establishment of religion by the state. But it doesn't, if it happens all the time. In second and third grade, if the kids are telling kids to come to their baptism and the parents upset, you say, until it's harassment, I can't stop that. That's a kid, an American kid to an American kid. They can't do it during my school day. I mean, they can't do it during my school lectures. They can do it on the playground. They can do it at lunch. They can pray at schools. They can develop clubs that are the We Love Everyone LDS Club, say, or the whatever it would be, that get to be announced like any other club. They could even have a scripture associated with it, you know, and that gets announced over the PA. That gets, you know, there's all kinds of things that can be done. It will help remove some of the radioactivity and the toxicity from the very word religion, from the very word belief, almost. I am one who, especially when I first came to Utah, felt protected by a very high wall of separation between church and state, especially in the public schools, to protect minority values and religions. But over time, I've come to see that religion just seems so pornographic to some kids. You can't talk about religion at all. Well, yeah, you can. You can't proselyte. You can't establish religion. But my goodness, you cannot understand America, at least, and so many other places, without a history of religion. And I'm going to suggest you something that you should be troubled about. I'm an outdoorsman, and I like to hike, and I'm a scouter, and I ride horses on trails, and I run trails. And I look at old maps. You know, a lot of Mormon place names are being removed off of the map. They're just going away. You know, little Mormon girl mine isn't there anymore on the map. So all kinds of things. And it looks to me like, on purpose, Mormon is being spelled M-O-R-M-A-N a lot. You know, I don't know, just weird things happen. Well, we've got to not let that happen in our public schools, and in our history, too. Go ahead. Any other thoughts or questions or problems? So students need to know they can do that. And teachers need to know that they violate the establishment, the free exercise clause, when they tell someone, oh, no, we got to be respectful. You can't tell so-and-so they're going to hell or whatever. Well, be careful, because the state doesn't get to come along. We can teach respect, and we can teach how not to harass in the schools, and we can teach how to show respect. That doesn't mean that we, as the schools, can tell someone you can't testify to someone else. You can't witness to someone else at the playground, or if you open the space in the curriculum. If you open and say, what are the values you live your life by? Well, how can you silence religion if you did that? And so kids need to know they can do it. Now, as an LDS kid growing up in Arizona, my pulse rate and my visceral response always went up anytime we taught American history and the American West, the westward expansion, the Mormons. And I always had to stand up that some egghead teacher was teaching false doctrine. And it's uncomfortable to be the only Mormon kid there to do it. Other kids are very happy, very comfortable, and I'm uncomfortable, and I have to stand up and say, you know, I think you got it wrong. And it's not fun for a 16-year-old who just wants to be cool, or a 14-year-old or whatever, to have to say those things. You know what? It's pretty good for kids that are believers to do that. And so yeah. I'm going to suggest they need to know what they can and can't do. Back behind you, and then we'll come back up to you.
So I hear about different efforts to create civility in schools, or anti-bullying, or things of that sort. What are some of the best things that you've seen happening that
Good
create
question.
That kind of environment?
So she's talking about the anti-bullying environment of a school, what you need to do with anti-bullying, that includes, it should include religious kids, but it also certainly includes protection for gay kids and lesbian kids and transgender kids and kids who are on their way to transgender. And just in Utah, I've counseled people, dealt with people who are hermaphrodites. You know, we can't say it's all this or it's all that. We need to be open to individual difference and how we make their lives not hellish. And so all the states have done laws. When I came out, I thought it was kind of funny, but then I realized it's virtue. Laws against bullying. It has happened all around the U.S. Just like 4 or 5 years ago, I think it was. And Utah adopted them. Utah adopted laws about anti-bullying. As if the schools already didn't have regulations against bullying. But what was powerful about it, and what answers this question in part, is they outlined a process you have to go through. And that's what's salutary, that you have to have this community type of community member, this type of community member, this type of, these people together to define what bullying is. Well, that process of getting everybody together and defining what bullying is 90% of the win. And then you have to decide, and this is what Utah's statute says, and other statutes do too, they required them to make their own and to use a model policy. And then they were supposed to put a model policy on our state website, which they didn't do for over a year. So a lot of people use South Carolina's, which had a kind of a model policy. So just so you know, South Carolina's not a bad policy on bullying. If you want to go to the website of their state, but we have one in Utah now too, go to our state Office of Education. And so there's a process and includes what will be the interventions or punishments for what. And so know that policy, have input into what, how it's defined, and that we revisit it regularly and say, hey, let's have the whole community understand, because it's the observers that don't do anything that really have a lot to do with the climate of bullying in the world, in a sense. And a lot of it is cyberbullying. Cole, I'm going right till 2, is that right? Or do I stop before? Right till 2. Okay, thank you. I have another. Is that okay? So that's a very powerful question. And we need to show that this other research is wrong, that deeply religious people are pro-social and altruistic and care.
I just wonder if there's any policies in Utah where about inviting outside experts into, let's say, high school classes. So in part of my civic engagement, I went into the office of the Seattle Office of National Abortion Rights Action League, okay? And on your blackboard is teaching or speaking engagements in public school.
Interesting.
And so my question is, if the school districts have policies on teaching controversial subjects, so if they invite Planned Parenthood in, they've got to invite a pro-life speaker.
You would like to think that, wouldn't you? You'd like to think they would do that. The issue, so Utah, for example, we're what we call an opt-in state. When it comes to health ed or sex ed or those kinds of issues, there are states that are opt out, there are states that are opt in, and we're definitely, you can't teach anything about human procreation or anything in Utah, although we'll have to see what happens to Common Core and what happens to the teaching about family life over in the future, without the parents knowing the exact curriculum and seeing it, and you're not allowed to answer spontaneous questions. No questions get answered. Kid can ask it, shut up. You know, you want to say, you're just doing that for interest's sake, you know. And those questions, you know, ask your parents, I'm not allowed to answer that. And so that can help in some states. Otherwise, it depends. And a lot of cases, like the Harper versus Turley case that I talked about, they have learning standards that require you to learn about the different types of families. And so it's hurt believers' families and the way that things work for them in powerful ways, but it was adopted by the legislature. So now we have to kind of be involved in the legislative arena so that the standards that we adopt for school boards, after they've been delegated to us, you know, from statutes, are effective. So some of it you just can't take care of, but we need to be careful about that. It's really terrible. I'm going to reserve 2 minutes at the end for me. Let's take this one, though.
Okay, just really quickly. Along with the bullying question, I feel like the issue of defining prejudice is a defining moment for us at this time.
True.
Defining prejudice without including doctrinal basis for believers has led to the idea that believers are hate-filled. How do
we
take back that issue and redefine it?
Well,
perhaps homosexuals have.
That's a powerful thing, defining what it means to be prejudiced. Like I was showing about that research, you know. And so, by the way, you may want to look at my article again. I have a site for it somewhere. Anyway, just email me, ferrin@byu.edu, ferrin@byu.edu, or go to the Google and thumb them. Just go to Google and put in BYU Educational Law Journal and my last name, Ferrin, and you'll get the article. Okay, and then look for the sites and the things about that, because that's the challenge. If you define prejudice by the way people answer, like I said, it's natural for people to be homosexual and bisexual, and that's a good thing or whatnot, and it'd be good if we taught that it was natural, well, it's going to hit some people one way and some people the other way, and it's not necessarily an indicator of prejudice. And by the way, we're missing out on poverty and race if we're dealing with this so much. So thank you, please.
I think one of the challenges we face is that a lot of religious people are prejudiced and bigoted. And so there's a conflation of doctrinally based, you know, beliefs about morality and prejudiced beliefs from people who also claim.
That's right. That's a very good comment. Very good point. So we need to be an example of the believers. Yeah. We need to be on the same, because again, they divided up quest, intrinsics, extrinsics, and quests. And the deepest believers are the ones that they seem to say are less pro-social. And we need to be out teaching, understanding that. We need to seize the vocabulary and the issues. I'm just going to close with this. If you wanted to look at Utah's regs on these sorts of things, one of my students who has a law degree from our college, from our university, and a doctorate from my department, helped write these, and others did too. R-277-105 in the Utah Administrative Code, it's talking about recognizing constitutional freedoms in the schools, and it has some powerful things to say about rights to waive out of parts of the curriculum. And they're conscientious rights, they're not even religious rights that have to be pulled, you know, that have to be cited for that. And rights of employees in the schools to not to, to speak out their own beliefs and the rightness or wrongness of someone else's beliefs. That's interesting. It may go ultra vires, may go beyond, may be unconstitutional, but you might want to read it and look at it. Look at it as a good attempt to deal with some of these challenges and questions. R-277-105 in the Utah Administrative Code. So that's a regulation, not a statute. It's a reg in Utah. So look at those things, stay engaged, be an example of someone who's not full of hate and can learn to speak your vocabulary and can handle the intense boredom followed by pain of being engaged, you know, both in the PTA but also on the school board and on committees for the schools and whatnot. Good luck. Thank you very much. Interesting future.